If you really want to get raw on Monday nights, tune into the Beyond Ringside Radio Network at 9:30 p.m. Eastern, 8:30 Central Time for the Midnight Black Mass Podcast. Myself, the Reverend Dan the Dragon Wilson, along with the Strong Style Psycho Tank and Andrew Alexander, bring you a truly blood-curdling experience. Uncensored, uncut, and only on the Beyond Ringside Radio Network.
Forget all you know about podcasts. We welcome you to an experience. Uniquely different. Please join us for our coverage of all entertainment on the fringe of society. The candles are lit. The lights are down low. It is now time as he steps up to the pulpit, the sacrifice has been prepared for the midnight black.
Ghastly greetings, groovy ghoulies, and how the hell are ya? I am your host, the maniacal minister of the occult, the Reverend Dan the Dragon Wilson, and welcome to the Midnight Black Mass on the Beyond Ringside Radio Network. Would like to introduce my co-hosts at this time. First, probably has a pending sexual harassment allegation out there to come forth at some point, but we'll enjoy his company while we can. Andrew Alexander, how are you?
Dude, I was literally thinking last night, I was watching Saturday Night Live, and I thought, good God, if I become a public figure, if I ran for office, I am fucked. Because I don't care what Kevin Spacey or that dude from Alabama or whoever the fuck, I don't care what they did, I know I've done worse. I know it. Like, they said that dude from Alabama, they said he had inappropriate relations with teenagers. Now, that's not specific. If you're talking 13, 14, 15, okay, I've never went down that path. But if you're talking 18, 19, shit, I would do that right now. And I wouldn't lose a second sleep about it. And fuck you if you don't like it.
So glad to have you back. Andrew's been off of the show for a couple weeks. I mean, hell, we hadn't been on the air in a few weeks. But even before that, when we did the little brief Halloween special with me and Eddie and episodes prior, he hadn't been able to make it. So glad to have you back, fucker.
It's not my fault.
Oh, no one's casting blame. I'm just trying to be positive and say I'm glad to have you back. Well, you got to read into shit.
How many episodes have I missed? One.
Not many.
That's right.
You've been out on assignment a few times.
That's right.
And the third pillar of the podcast, now happily enjoying retirement. He hadn't been able to be on the air in a few weeks because of a case of laryngitis. So we know the missus has been keeping him busy in retirement. The Strong Style Psycho Tank, what's up, man?
What's going on, motherfuckers? First day I've had an actual voice in like a month, so hopefully I don't fuck it up doing this goddamn podcast.
Well, get used to the idea so you can remember what it was like when you had a voice, because after talking for a fucking hour, it's going to be gone again.
Oh, yeah, it is.
So, lots of things have happened since we've been away. A lot of things in wrestling and not wrestling related. You know, we talk about lots of pop culture things here on the show. Anybody seen Thor Ragnarok yet?
Yep, twice.
Yes.
Excellent. We can chat about that for a second. Holy shit, what a great movie.
Oh, yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed it. I always get with you guys about characters and shit because I don't read the comics. I just watch the movies, but I thought it was pretty badass, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. I know some people are shitting on the comedy, but hell, I thought it was good too. So I would definitely see it again.
Yeah, I loved it. Tank asked me if it was on the same level as Civil War, and that's just not, it's just not a good comparison because they're just different movies, different tones all around. But I mean, it might be a 10 out of 10. I mean, it honestly might. It's definitely a 9 out of 10.
Yeah, it's one of the best Marvel movies ever, in my opinion, and a surprise. I, myself, being a fan of the Thor mythos and knowing some stuff about the comics, and his individual stories, not just with the Avengers, like, I enjoyed the first two Thor movies, but to say they are not the favorite of the Marvel Cinematic Universe fans would be an understatement. Most people don't fucking like the Thor movies, particularly The Dark World. The first one is a little more split, but opinion of the public persuasion on the sequel, Thor the Dark World, is pretty crappy.
Why is that? I enjoyed Dark World. Why is that?
I did as well. I think that they just like felt like it wasn't breaking any new ground. You know, it was just a pretty like traditional, straightforward movie, which I thought was fine. I thought it needed like, and it was very serious, and it took the characters very serious, and a lot of people didn't think that played as well with kind of the bizarre, abstract, cosmic construct of that corner of the Marvel Universe. So I do think with Thor Ragnarok, where they did kind of play up the silliness of it and the whole trippy cosmic aspect of it and just being like, okay, it's fucking absurd, so let's treat it like it's fucking absurd. And it really clicked. Like, it just really worked.
Yeah, those people that had a problem with, that's like the people that see matches at WrestleMania and they can be like really fucking good matches, but they're like, I don't know, it wasn't anything new or groundbreaking. Because WrestleMania has become so huge, that's kind of the same thing with the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Like, it's kind of hard to please people. And they keep raising the bar. Like Thor, again, like a lot of the movies, is going to be really fucking hard to top. Like really hard. The next one is Black Panther, and you know that's going to be a completely different film than Thor Ragnarok is. So, yeah, fuck those people. I like it.
Yeah, the only thing about the first two Thors that I didn't like was Kat Dennings didn't show her tits, but on the other thing.
I'll agree with that.
The thing
would have been nice.
Yo, you're not getting that in a Marvel movie, pal.
Oh, no. I know.
You're not even getting that on, like, the Marvel Netflix. You get, like, a side boob, but I don't, you know. They'll show somebody's brains getting splattered across hell and half of creation, but, you know, no boob. Side boob is all you're getting. Enjoy the side boob. That's all that's allowed.
I mean, I've gone through a lot of trials and tribulations and just a lot of changes as you grow and mature as a person, but I just love fucking titties.
Me too.
That's just never going to change. That Kat Dennings bitch was on that show, Two Broke Girls. That is the most unrealistic shit ever, because if you got titties like that, you ain't going to be broke, bitch.
Getting back to Thor, though, I mean, I like the music was awesome. I like how they used Led Zeppelin, Immigrant Song, during the fight scenes and stuff. I thought it was badass. I thoroughly enjoyed it.
I also like kind of like the new rebirth of the Thor character a little bit. The, like, you know, cool him up a little. Like, oh, he's a little war-torn. And, you know, they cut off his metal-as-fuck hair, but you know, I thought having some evolution was not a bad thing in the case of that character in terms of how it had been presented.
I went and got a haircut Thursday, and the chick asked, she's like, so what do you want me to do, the usual? And I said, have you seen Thor Ragnarok? She goes, no. And I said, eh, that's probably for the best. Because, like, I dug the hair. I mean, I don't like that they did it, but I dug his haircut. But then I was like, man, I don't know. That's just, if you're not Thor, you're probably going to look like a douchebag. If you're not Thor in the rap game, you can't pull it off. I was like, I had a wild hair. So if she would have said, yeah, I've seen it, there could have been problems. But crisis avoided.
Damn it. Now I wish you had done it.
All the shit with the Hulk and Banner, I thought was great. And, you know, I even texted Andy during the movie bitching about Thor or Hulk talking so much. Like he explained, he's been gone for 2 years and babies learn how to talk. So that made sense.
Yeah, well, then the Hulk took over. So it was like he was present, you know, most of the time.
The one thing I did not like, and I knew as soon as it happened why it happened, but Lady Sif, who is on the show that I absolutely love, Blind Spot, she's the star of that show, she couldn't be in the film because of filming of a season 3 of Blind Spot. But they didn't mention her at all. And it was probably a smart move on her part because the other Warriors 3 just got murdered, like, instantly. So she probably prolonged her appearances in the MCU because I got a feeling if she was there, she would have been killed too. But they just didn't say shit. Like, tell me something. Say she's off somewhere fucking or Loki tied her up or something. They just didn't mention her at all. That's the only complaint I had.
Yeah. Well, she didn't make an appearance in the play, but it was an actress playing her in the reenactment of the Thor story. So,
and even that,
but
I
yeah,
it was like a rib because they like say her name and she runs off. She even that little character is on the screen for about 1.5 seconds. But other than that, I mean, what character wasn't awesome? I mean, I thought Hela was great. Valkyrie was great. Jeff Goldblum was fucking awesome as usual. I mean, Hulk, just everything about it, man. It was just great. It was a really, really fun time. Good shit. Good way to keep
the dude,
MCU going.
The Rock guy, he was funny as shit.
Yeah.
What was his name? Borg, or you're talking about Doug? That was funny as hell.
Oh, Doug's dead.
And then Carl Urban, what was he, the Destroyer or Screech or some shit? He was badass, you know, when he had the fucking machine guns and the fucking shake weights. And, you know, he was just bringing shit back from Earth. This is Dis and Stroy. And I popped for that.
Yeah, he was awesome.
All right, go ahead.
No, I was like he, I can't remember his name. The executioner,
Scourge.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, he's awesome. I just hate that they killed him off at the end. Spoiler alert. Because fucking, you know, him and the Enchantress is like a great thing from the comics, and you know, we're probably not gonna get to see that, but whatever. He's still awesome.
Yeah, when are we going to see the Enchantress in the MCU? I'm really surprised that she has not made an appearance yet.
Well, they got to save some of them.
That's true. I mean, that is true.
But what I was going to say is, people in my circle know I'm well known for paying for one movie and seeing 3 or 4 in one day. The same day I saw Thor, I went and saw the biggest piece of shit movie I'd seen in a long time, and that was Jigsaw. Is the dreadful?
Oh, did it suck?
Shit. Oh my god!
Man,
the kills were cool. You know, the traps, you know, all that stuff's cool. But the story is just so fucking stupid and absurd. And I mean, I didn't pay for the goddamn movie, and I almost got up and walked the fuck out because it was that goddamn stupid. But I had to see the finish, and the finish made it even fucking worse.
Yeah, I really wanted to see that just because I have seen all the other Saw movies. And after you said that, I was like, well, fuck, I'll just wait for Redbox. So, I mean, the next movie...
I texted Andy as soon as it was over. It was like, this is the biggest piece of shit I've ever seen.
Damn it.
Yeah, I mean, the next movie clearly will be Justice League, but after I do want to see A Bad Mom's Christmas. I really like that movie. And then Daddy's Home 2, that's what I want to see for the holiday season. So they're definitely on the list. And then, of course, the big one, the big boy, Star Wars, son.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Just a few weeks away from that episode 9, and it's getting real.
Yeah, I believe I'm going to take that night off work just to fucking go see it 2 or 3 times because I think it's going to be awesome.
But, yeah, it's got to be good. I keep messing that up.
I did watch a pretty cool movie on the Fire Stick the other day called Atomic Blonde with Charlize Theron. She's hotter than fuck. She's like a female John Wick. You need to check it out. She fucks a lot of people up.
I've watched a fuckload of movies. What's that?
Of course, Punisher starts Friday on Netflix, so I guess get your binge watching ready to go.
And I'm so pissed. I'm going to be so busy this weekend. Like, I will not get to watch 1 second of that.
Yeah, I'll be binging the fuck out of it Friday night.
I'll get some of it. I'm going to that Trios Tournament Saturday, but then... And then I guess when I got home, I was going to watch the War Games match, see how bad they fucked that up.
Yeah, let's talk about War Games.
Talk about it. I know it's happening.
Okay, well, for starters, I've heard there's not a top on the cage.
There's not?
Nope.
That's fucking horseshit.
They're in little
pods.
It's
already
pods
fucking ruined.
They're in little pods. There's 3 teams of 3. So, I mean, it is very not War Games-like. It does have the 2 rings. That's good. I mean, I ain't going to knock it till I see it. I'm sure it'll be fun, but... I mean, why can't you put a fucking top on the cage? What the hell?
Yeah, I don't know, man.
I mean, hell, they could just build a big-ass Hell in a Cell and then close both fucking rings, and it'd be the same goddamn thing. You know, not having a top, I don't know about that. And the 3 teams, I mean, it'll be interesting to see what happens. You know, there ain't going to be no blood. So, that'll be out.
I finally got caught up on NXT the past 2 days to see how they set it up and stuff. And the build was not good at all. Like, it was just thrown out there very random, very quickly. The whole team, you know, it's a makeshift team of Roderick Strong and the Authors of Pain. It was just, I don't know, just very forced. Not built up very much at all, but let's talk about good War Games. There's a few of them. Me and Tank were talking about this, Dan, a little bit, texting about it. What's your favorite War Games match? Like, what, in your opinion, is the best one?
It's a tough one. What's yours, Tank?
No, you got to go first. I mean, me and Tank, we don't want to influence your answer.
Dan goes first.
All right, fair enough. Without sounding like a homer mark for myself, probably the 2006 Anarchy War Games, because it was definitely the bloodiest one, but not really a true, like, you know, if 2 rings, like NWA War Games for sure, and was definitely done in tribute to all of those matches. So, 92, I love that fucking match. Like, hard to top the original, of course. Like, it was a bloodbath. I think Luger was the only person that didn't get color in that. But yeah, I think as far as like a match overall, 92.
Okay, that's what we said.
I mean, 91 is fucking good as fuck.
Is that the one where Pillman got dropped on his head?
Yep.
When that fucked up power bomb. And I was at the first four games, you know, and being 16, 17 years old, I thought it was great. It was the first one. It had, you know, it had a good story behind it. You know, the Horsemen just, you know, beat the fuck out of Dusty for so many years. I believe that was 87. 88, they took it on tour. They had one here in Chattanooga. And it was the Horsemen against Road Warriors, Steve Williams, Sting, and Luger, I believe. And it was cool, you know, seeing it again in person. You know, with the same finish, JJ gets fucked up.
Dan, let me ask you three quick follow-up questions. Number one, would you agree that Lex Luger is a little bit of a pussy for not getting Okada?
I mean, he had to protect the moneymaker.
Okay. Okay, let me continue with that.
But not as like he did get color like at other occasions, so I'm not sure why he didn't do it there. But
when did he get color? I can't recall us ever seeing him bleed.
Bash 88, motherfucker. The main event was stoppage for blood. Now, I mean, it was a trickle, so they probably shouldn't have relied on Luger to get the good color. But you remember when he was, like, rocking the tough guy beard?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a cage match with Flair, like, Wrestle War, maybe? Or he got some pretty damn good color in that.
Okay, let me ask you this. Would you agree that anyone whose favorite wrestler is Lex Luger is a pussy?
No, we're trying to bury Muji.
Okay. Serious question. Are you aware that War Games is very—it's very much remembered as this great gimmick match, and everybody's wanted to see it return, and everyone's excited about it, and all that. But are you aware that most of them actually suck?
No, most of them don't suck. There are some that suck a lot, but I'd say more good than bad.
No.
That might be cutting it close, but I'd say it. More good than bad. I mean, like, okay, the one where the NWO, like, and they had, like, oh, Sting turned to the NWO, but then he didn't, and then he did. That one fucking sucked. And I think, wasn't that the same one that Kurt Hennig turned and joined the NWO? Or was that a different one?
That was the next year. So they both
okay,
sucked.
And that one sucked as well. And anyone after that in WCW also sucked, but there weren't many. There was like maybe one more after that.
Okay, real quickly, and then Tank, you chime in with your thoughts here. Okay, 92 was the best one ever. 93 featured the Shockmaster. Harlem Heat, Sting, British Bulldog, that whole thing. Not good. It sucked.
God, I don't even remember that one.
Which is a good
94 was one with Terry Funk and fucking Bunkhouse Buck. And, like, you can't convince me that one sucks, even though there's no color. Like, it's so fucking entertaining.
You can't convince me that it's good.
I think it's fucking awesome.
Fucking matches.
Okay, 95.
Where his fucking Ming comes in and breaks the fucking... Yeah, no, that match is fucking awesome, because that period in WCW sucked, and that shit was, you know, some of the rare fucking good stuff.
Okay, 95, Dungeon of Doom versus Hogan, Sting, Luger, and Savage. Please defend that one.
For the time, it was over. And, you know, it wasn't a great match memorably, but it was like the Hogan formula. You know, Hogan is a babyface. Like, it was all the shit people wanted to see, so I wouldn't consider it bad.
Well, thank you for joining us on the Midnight Black Mass. Our podcast is officially done because we've lost all credibility in a wrestling fan's eyes.
It was not a good technical wrestling match by any fucking stretch of the imagination, if that's what we're trying to get out. But you, as well as I, know that that's not the only fucking barometer to determine something's good or not. Did it sell tickets? Did it get over?
No! No! It didn't get over! Tank, will you tell me?
I mean, a lot of these matches, I don't even fucking remember. I do remember the one with Shockmaster because the finish was a bear hug. But the other ones,
yeah, that one fucking sucked.
I know the one Flair got his head slammed in the cage. Wasn't there one? It was like WCW, NWO, and then the Ultimate Warrior had a fucking team or something.
Oh,
yeah,
God.
Be a part of War Games one time. I would say the WCW runs from like 95 until they closed shop were pretty shitty because they were just fucking stupid. But the early ones, 87 was awesome. The tour in 88 was awesome. They didn't do one in 89 or 90, but 91 was good. 92, like, you know, we said was the best one.
Okay, well, yeah. Then I stand corrected. I was wrong. There were one more bad than good, so bad
I will
slightly
say, a lot of these matches, I have to go back and watch them because I really don't remember them. I don't even remember Terry Funk being in a War Games. But let's talk about War Games 2006 at Anarchy. That was fucking awesome. It's on like on YouTube. You can watch it. I brought in the fucking thumbtack bat and goddamn Nemesis hit Catfish in the face with it. I was like, well, that's uncalled for.
That's too far even for war.
Because I fucking brought it in so they could use it on me. You know, I was the one going to take all the thumbtacks in the head, thinking that was going to be it. And he came in and beat the fuck out of Catfish with it. So I had to cut him off.
What was the War Games in 2007?
Mountain Center.
Yeah, Rejects versus the Elite.
I think I remember that. What was the best match on that card?
Scotty Wren and Mickey Free against the Urban Assault Squad.
Oh, my God. The podcast is dead. The podcast is done.
But were people coming here for our hot takes on fucking professional wrestling?
I don't know why people listen, to be honest with you.
Yeah, that one was crazy because, of course, Catfish again, fucking the way it was set up, they had barbed wire under the cage, and he went through the shit to the floor, all hung up in it. I was like, that's not necessary.
I don't think you meant to.
Mm-mm. Yeah, the cage was the shit. It was big as hell, and there was like a 2-foot gap in between the ring and the goddamn cage. And it was crazy.
And so they thought, well, to secure the cage and fill that gap, we'll put some barbed wire down there.
Wow.
And so, Catfish, who is Azrael, by the way, for those who don't know, we're over here talking in our fucking insider jargon, but he somehow got dumped, like, you know, took the bump into the cage and was going to slide down the cage and get back in the ring, and I guess he didn't realize there was that big of a gap, and so he took the bump into the cage and slid down the cage and kept sliding. Yeah, there was a giant gap, and then he landed in a net of barbed wire.
Man, I had something else I wanted to talk to you guys about on this podcast, and I've been forgot what that shit is. That's gonna bug
me. Let me bring something up. What are your thoughts on the independence is a big thing now, fucking intergender matches? between men and women. I mean, they got tags, singles, six man, what have you. What's your take on it?
Oh, boy. To say this as diplomatically as possible, I generally don't book them. I will not say I would never book one. The story would just have to be right. Like, situation has to be believable for the type of wrestling that I present. Others may disagree with that and may present their wrestling a different way. But for the way I know how to do shit, it's something that should be used very sparingly to great effect and on rare occasions.
I think anything, if done right, can be done. I don't think it's fair to ever say never. But intergender matches, I think they're definitely better when it's the situation where it's men touch the men, women touch the women, et cetera, et cetera. Maybe a man pulls a cheap shot on a chick to get heat. Maybe a babyface chick hits a big high spot on a dude to get a pop. That type of stuff's cool. But just straight up man versus woman in a competitive match and things such as that, that just doesn't strike me as a great idea. Again, certain situations, certain ways it can be done, it's okay. But yeah, it seems to be very popular where it's just done to fucking do it. And it's not that I'm all for, I'm not about women's wrestling and shit. I truly believe women can do anything men can do, except stand-up comedy, of course. But other than that, I mean, I'm all for the women's right and the women's revolution in wrestling. But, you know, they should stick with wrestling the chicks. Dudes should stick to wrestling the dudes.
Yeah, I feel the same way. I mean, like you said, if it's a tag match, like you said, the women touch women, men touch men, the heel gets a cheap shot on the female for the finish or get a heat. But, like, some of these matches I've gone through and watched a shit ton of them on, like, Powerbomb and High Spots, where they go, like, 20 minutes, and it's just move for move. Man, I don't get that shit. I don't like it. Fucking stupid. And y'all know me. I'm not a big fan of women's wrestling anyway. But then you add that to the mix, that just turns me off even more. I mean, since some of these girls are very, very talented, I'm not knocking them. That's just... And I'm not saying that a girl can't whip a dude. But in this business, I just don't think it meshes well. But for some reason, the fans love that shit, especially if it's like a, you know, some over-the-top, really over female and a over-the-top, really over guy, and they have a match. I mean, like I watched one with Cedric Alexander and that – chick who teams up with Joey Ryan. I mean, she legit is like 98 pounds and was giving this dude Ranas and all kinds of shit. German suplexes. I'm like, come on, god damn it. Don't do that. But, you know, I watched a match the other day where this well-known independent tag team lost to these two girls clean in the middle of the fucking ring, and I legit turned the shit off and was like, I ain't watching this shit no more. I'm done.
Yeah, I mean, what? You know, there's... Go ahead.
Go ahead. No, go ahead. Go ahead.
No, I already forgot what I was going to say. Go ahead.
why has a woman not capitalized on the popularity and everything, and why has she made her gimmick that she's the Secret City bitch?
Wait, like what? She does,
like she does suplexes, and she's the Suplex City bitch.
Oh.
That's her name. Like, that's good. That's money.
As long as she's suplexing other women, I ain't got a problem with it.
She just dumps them on their fucking head all day long. Like a female Scott.
I know you're one of your heroes, Edge, was shitting all over Oscar on his podcast. I didn't hear it. I read a transcript of it saying he didn't really get her. I mean, hell, I think she's pretty good.
Yeah, I like her. I like her quite a bit. I mean, to be honest with you, I was thinking the other day, she's not. I like women in wrestling more than her. Your Sherry's and your Miss Elizabeth, but I like them for. And I know Sherry was a wrestler, but that's not what I remember her for. But she might be my favorite female wrestler of all time. I mean, honestly, she's so different. She's good. She's got a presence. I mean, she has more of a presence than probably any chick I've ever seen.
Yeah.
I mean, I really can't think of someone. There may be people that are better, but she's probably my favorite female of all time.
I did see a match from Japan that popped me where she worked I believe it was a 6-person tag, and she was against Minoru Suzuki, who is a legit badass in Japan. He just beat the goddamn out of her. It wasn't, he wasn't working with her. He was just slapping the shit out of her. Was it a little overboard? Yeah, but, that's in most cases how it's going to be. If I'm going to wrestle a 100-pound woman, and, she's going to try to give me a German suplex, I'm going to spin and back fist the bitch. I mean, it's just, I know I'm very not politically correct, but goddamn, some of the shit's got to stop. And this is crazy. God damn it. What happened to fucking this wrestling getting over instead of having to stop a match to do a fucking thriller dance routine to get a pop? It's just fucking dumb.
I mean, a lot of the veterans say, that wrestling now is kind of a parody of wrestling, that it's not actually wrestling. And, I don't wholesale agree with that, but I think in some cases, if you're not careful, it can quickly turn into that. And if you're presenting a realistic style, which I think if you're trying to make money, is still the best way to do it, but apparently that's an antiquated way of thinking now. Well, so what the fuck do I know? Oh, yeah. Like, I feel like I don't know shit anymore because all the shit that I knew and learned over the years don't really fucking apply anymore. So now what?
Yeah. What we learned don't mean shit. It's just fucking crazy. Like you said, what the hell do I know?
Yeah, like guys ask me for advice and shit now, and I'm like, well, I'll tell you, And I mean, there's still the guys that, I work with on the regular that just trust my method. But, a lot of guys come up to me and ask me for advice and shit in their mask, and I'm like, I can tell you some, basic shit, but, a lot of the old things that I know and tricks of the trade are just not applicable anymore. So, fuck it. Why are you asking me? I don't know shit.
Yeah, I've had people ask me shit like that, and I just straight up I said, man, I can't tell you nothing. I don't even know what's happening these days. I mean, at the Scenic City Invitational, somebody, a very talented person, asked me some shit like that, and I was like, dude, I can't tell you shit to do. Just go out there and do your thing, and it's going to be better than anything I tell you. I'm going to tell you to grab a fucking headlock and sit on it for about 10 minutes.
Yeah, that's the thing. They want advice, but then they won't fucking, do it. So, I'm the same way. I mean, I have people now send me messages, hey, what do I need to do? I was like, hey, you ain't going to listen to me no fucking way, so I'm not going to tell you.
No, actually isn't the case with this guy. I mean, he would have listened and considered stuff I said and things like that. I don't think he would have shit on it. I just meant that, especially at the Scenic City Invitational, this is not the type of environment that I would thrive in any way, shape, or form. Like, I'm not going to tell you nothing that's going to get over with these people.
But I'm going to change subjects again here. I was watching something on the High Spots Network, and I noticed I hadn't seen him since I retired. But, man, Gunnar Miller is a goddamn monster. He did a spot and for PWX where he ran in and beat up John Schuyler, and I couldn't get over how goddamn big he had gotten in the last 2 months. I hadn't seen him. I was like, Jesus Christ.
Oh, was he big?
Wow, this dude ain't all over the country. Oh, man, he is so fucking ripped.
He is all over the country. Hadn't you been paying attention? He did a triple shot weekend on Halloween, and he's doing another one on Thanksgiving where he's doing, like, three fucking promotions in a row in three different states, man. He is getting out there.
Awesome. Well, I know he did the one, but, you know, I was...
He's about to announce another debut for a January date that he just told me about today. So, yeah, he's going all over the place and defending the Anarchy title at most places and, you know, elevating the brand of the promotion as well. So, you know, say a lot about Bailey and the company he keeps, but we certainly are glad to have a champion like Gunnar Miller.
Yeah, I know.
I knew it was just going to be a matter of time before he, you know, got out and started doing his shit elsewhere. You know, and as this run he does here, man, if he don't get picked up or signed within a year or so, I'm going to be very disappointed. Because we've all had a hand in this guy. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
So he needs, I mean, I'm sure he's going to make us proud regardless. But like I said, we've all had a hand in this fella, you know, telling, you know, giving him advice. And he's one of the guys, he will fucking listen.
And oh, you don't, I always say it, and Bailey always says it, but it's true. You don't have to tell him the same thing twice. Like, you tell him motherfucker one time, and he's got it. Like, every one time I was giving him shit over his punches, you know, I was like, man, come on. You're throwing these fucking door knockers and they're just fucking filling space. They don't mean shit. Like, you know, make that shit count. So I sent him hours upon hours of Memphis footage. I was like, watch these motherfuckers throw punches. And then the next fucking match he had, he was like, how are my punches? I was like, they were fucking perfect, of course.
Yeah, I know I'm saying the obvious, but I have a good friend from the Pro Wrestling Super Shop that I met from Cleveland, David. He went to the Georgia Premier show last Friday in Cleveland that had Jerry Lawler, Ricky Steamboat, Brian Christopher, which I heard a really good show for those guys, and I was happy to hear it. But he came in that Saturday talking to me, and he said, man, I saw this guy at that show that was amazing. Like, he was an absolute star. And I said, who, Gunnar Miller? And he says, oh, yeah, you know him? I said, yeah, I know him. He said, I went up. And this guy's an old school fan. This guy knows his shit. He's been around. He knows. He's been watching wrestling since literally the 60s and 70s. He said he went up to him afterwards and he said, sir, I don't know how serious you are about the profession, but if you want to be a top star in this business, you're going to be. And he told him that, you know, he was very, very open and saying, yes, sir, I am taking it serious and blah, blah, blah. And I told him, I confirmed. I said, oh, yeah, he's the real deal. He's going to get signed. But that's just a guy.
Yeah.
I mean, he didn't know that I knew him. And he's just and he's seen everything there is to see in wrestling. And he knew immediately. He's like, this is the guy right here.
Let me tell you what he did Halloween weekend. So Friday night, he goes up to the Washington, D.C. area and debuts for Nova Pro Wrestling. And defeats Indy Darling, Tim Donst, in an Anarchy title defense. Then Saturday, he comes to Anarchy for Fright Night. He defends the title against Jacob Ashworth in the final match of their year-long feud in a brutal fucking cage match and beats Jacob clean as a whistle in the cage. And then fucking goes to Nashville, Tennessee on Sunday and wrestles the 300-plus pound Kevin Lee Davidson for Southern Underground Pro Wrestling and successfully defends the Anarchy title against him as well. And he's got more of those weekends coming up. So that's the type of drive this guy has.
Man, I remember those days when I had that drive. Yeah, me too. Indianapolis one night, Cornelia the next, and then West Virginia, you know, just traveling all over the damn place. That was back when I was younger and able to do the shit. Then I was like, nah, I'm just going to go to Russell, Georgia for a couple of years. I'm good. But the promoters of Nashville, they had gotten a hold of me. I talked to Jesse all the time, and they were trying to get Elgin for that match, but he couldn't do it. He goes, who do you think we should get? And I said, get that KLD guy. He's big as hell. He's like Cyrus, as big as hell, can move. So he went ahead and booked it, and I've seen a little rough tape of the match, and it was badass. He gives him the jackhammer and everything. I was like, that's fucking awesome. I saw he gave Cyrus the jackhammer. Cyrus took it.
Yep,
like a
he did. They had a big two-match series in Cornelia where they beat the fucking piss out of each other. And, Gunner struggled to get him up for the jackhammer the first time. He didn't. Cyrus actually beat him by count-out, just barely, you know, beat him back into the ring after a big suplex on the floor. And then so Cyrus got his rematch. This time, Gunner, I guess he did a few extra squats because he got that big son of a bitch up for the fucking jackhammer and planted him. But Cyrus is coming for revenge this Saturday night, boys.
At the Trios Tournament.
Yep.
Yeah.
On my fucking birthday.
I think that'll be another barn burner. We can plug this. A lot of the teams I really don't know. I know the Lynch Mob and Kyle Matthews are a team. The Vikings, Jake Parnell, Alex Rudolph, and Big Frank.
Those guys are awesome.
Team Southern Underground. AJ Gray, maybe?
AJ Gray, Kevin Koo, and Jaden Newman. Yeah.
Okay. And then, Team Glory Pro, Kurt Stallion, Myron Reed, and they're bringing somebody with them. I don't know who it is. I'm the worst hype guy ever. I'm the promoter goddamn show.
Gary J.
Who?
Stiff Robo Ginger, Gary J.
Gary J. That little stiff bastard.
And there's an all
Carnies.
The Carnies, the good old boys in Torch. And who am I forgetting? The little fucking Mighty Duck guys. And somebody, I don't know. Ethan Case. Yeah, I think they're teaming with him or something. It'll be entertaining as hell. So you need to come to Hickson High School this Saturday in Chattanooga and check this show out, because it'll be – I like six-man tags, so I think it'll be a run of some good shit. And then, like you said, you got Cyrus and Gunnar Miller in a rematch. Is it for the Anarchy title?
My knowledge, it's not as of yet.
Okay.
They have not reached out to our matchmaking committee about making it for the title, but, you know, that could certainly change between now and Saturday.
Well, the goddamn needs to be a title match.
He's defended it everywhere else. He certainly has.
He'd go ahead and defend that son of a bitch here in Chattanooga.
That would be cool. I mean, you know, he's made it a mission to, you know, put Anarchy on his back as well. You know, and Anarchy's got some good publicity over the last couple of months between the Wildside reunion with AJ. I mean, hell, we got covered in Sports Illustrated for that shit. It's fucking awesome. And then, Chad Lale, now as his real name and his WWE name, the former Universal Soldier, Phil Shatter, former TNA Gunner, recently is in a pretty major movie. And he's actually get some FaceTime in the trailer, and I can't for the life of me remember the name of it right now, but WWE put an article, Game Night, there you go, on their website. And, of course, Chad, being the great dude that he is, just putting over his experience in Anarchy as well. So, keeping that momentum going, and Gunnar Miller is going to be the next guy on that list, I do believe.
We mentioned the Phoenix City Trios. I know there'll be an alternate team if there's an injury or someone backs out. It'll be myself, Tank, and Dan, Team Glory Hole Pro Wrestling.
Only if we come out to Steel Panther.
Ooh.
We sure will.
You know we will. That'd be awesome. I'm going in fucking street clothes. I'm just going to go in what the hell I'm wearing. I'm not going to bring any gear. Just go in street clothes.
Are we going to bring wooden boards out with holes cut in them?
That's right.
Yeah. That'd be awesome.
Hey, so I remembered what I wanted to bring up, and it's completely random and off topic. But it'll be a nice little quick conversation. I'm gonna say a championship, and I don't want you to think about it at all. I want you to tell me the first name that comes to the mind when you hear this title. You got to tell me who you think of. Who is the quintessential NWA/WCW television champion? Go, both of you.
Arn Anderson.
Well, there's nothing more to discuss here, gentlemen.
That was all you wanted to know?
Well, I mean, we all say Arn Anderson. So I don't know if there's much to talk about. That's just, you know, why do you say Arn Anderson?
Because he personified that belt. Like, he was the fighting TV champion. He was there every week having the best match. Oftentimes, you know, it was the day where the world champion didn't wrestle on every show, but you certainly got to see him more on TV there than you did in the WWF. But still, Arn was usually having the best match.
Oh, yeah, I went to a couple of, like, Omni shows, and, you know, he'd defend the TV title at house shows. And the three I went to, he lost all three matches. But, you know, the title was only on the line for the first 15 minutes, and he'd lose it, like, 15:35 or something. But, oh, yeah, every TV match you ever had was awesome. And he's one of the most underrated.
Go ahead.
He's one of the most underrated wrestlers of all time. Him and Bobby Eaton, they're my top two most underrated of all time.
You know, I agree with Eaton. I don't consider Arn Anderson an underrated wrestler because, yeah, in the fact that he never was like world champion or anything like that, but really anybody in wrestling that mentions his name is quick to say how amazing he is. So I don't know if he's technically underrated,
if
that makes sense. But
I think maybe he was not pushed to the level that he could have been, you know, possibly. Like, maybe he could have been the top guy if there wasn't a Flair there. You know what I'm saying? Like, so maybe that's where people say underrated, because I do hear that. But if everybody says you're underrated, you're not really underrated. So I agree with you.
Yeah, that's true.
Well,
Feel like Anderson, he was content in his role with NWA. You know, I don't think he went bitching, saying, you know, God damn it, I'm not getting, you know, they're not doing this with me, not doing that with me. Yeah, he was content with what the hell he was doing. He just seems like he's that type of guy. You know, he always made fun of people. He was the ultimate river and just tell people like it is. I mean, listening to the Shivani podcast, he said they did that Yeti gimmick. Dude walked in the back. He just walked up to him and said, just kill yourself now. That's funny as fuck. I mean, that's some shit, you know. Y'all know me. That's some shit I would say to somebody. Just go ahead and kill yourself now and get it over with. I'm the modern-day Arn Anderson. I just wasn't near as good.
Let me ask you guys real quick. Why do you think in all the years the WWE – I mean, I know why they couldn't do it now, but why do you think the WWE never tried anything like a TV title? Like, you know, pretty much every other promotion did.
They had an Intercontinental title. It was basically the same thing.
No, I mean the time limit, I don't know, it's just that model. They never did that. I mean, the U.S. title and Intercontinental title were similar and things like that. National title back in the day. But just to be like,
I don't think WWF like worried so much about continuity, like as much as with it being like a straight sport. Like, okay, so there's got to be a 15-minute time limit for this TV title. Like, and with their presentation, like everything was a movie, you know, even if it was a house show, like they were trying to sell you, like it could be on television. So like, I just feel like they kind of felt they were probably above it.
And if I could please, depending on the era, if you're talking about the era where it was Superstars and Challenge and they didn't have a real weekly network program, it would not have been able, there's the word continuity comes back into play again, because you're dealing with a situation where it's not a contiguous show with basic storylines running on a regular basis in WWE with Superstars and Challenge, whereas the TV title in the NWA was the subject of a multi-person storyline on more than one occasion.
Yeah. I mean, the TV title was a big deal. I mean, it was like one of those things. Oh, we got a TV title defense today, and it was like it was a big deal. If it was on TV, you knew he was going to win. If he defended that shit at the house show, he was losing after the 15-minute time limit.
I just think they've really fucked themselves with getting rid of time limits completely. I mean, there's so many matches I see booked and see on Raw and SmackDown where I'm like, see, person A is going to lose this match, and when you know person A should not fucking lose this match, but someone has to, and maybe person B is somebody they don't want to lose, and if you still have that time limit, that is the perfect way to get out of a match and to keep it going. You can bring it back the next week. You can create that drama with the crowd as far as the time limit running out, and they do not do that anymore. I don't understand.
A lot of modern wrestling eliminates the psychological tools from the toolbox, and it's just all what happens bell to bell. And I don't know, after a while, it gets a little numbing. But, you know, we could rant on that for hours. And we are out of time. So what a fun episode to get back in the swing of things. We'll be back right here next Monday night, 9:30 p.m. Eastern Time, 8:30 p.m. Central. Don't want to miss it here on the Beyond Ringside Radio Network. Anarchy Wrestling returns to the Landmark Arena November 25th. Kyle Matthews, the Nightmare, defends the Heritage Championship against Wild Billy Buck after their encounter, and a whole lot more matches to be announced moving forward on that event. Follow us on social media at Anarchy Landmark on Twitter, facebook.com/Anarchy Wrestling for more information about what I'm doing. Of course, Scenic City Invitational will be the Trios Tournament this weekend, Saturday night, Hickson High School. Follow them on Twitter at SCI Tournament for more info. Fast Eddie Layne will be joining me in the commentary booth, so we're going to have us a good time. Tank and Andrew Alexander are going to be there. Going to be a rowdy weekend in Chattanooga. Any final thoughts, gentlemen?
Yeah, I got a lot of plugs this weekend. I have so many, I thought about sending them to Fast Eddie so he could just inform me, but I'll go ahead and spit them out. Like Dan said, I'll be at the Scenic City Trios Tournament set up with the Pro Wrestling Super Shop. I'll be at the I-75 Flea Market Saturday and Sunday morning. But on top of that, I'll be in Clarksville, Tennessee for Tried and True Pro Wrestling on Friday. Main event is Bobby Lashley and James Storm, so that's a huge card. It's going to be an awesome show. And then Saturday night, I will have some of my minions representing the Pro Wrestling Super Shop at Pro Wrestling Lafayette in Lafayette, Georgia. Stars is Adam Jacobs, Bobby Hayes, a couple old Empire faithful there, great talent. And then Saturday afternoon, I'll be at the Hickson High School Pro Wrestling Super Shop at the Toy, Comic, and Card Show put on by the great Scott Hensley. And that's just in the afternoon, 9 to 2 p.m. before the Scenic City Trios. So I'm going to be everywhere this weekend. Probably the only time in the next year that I will do something like this, because it sounds exhausting.
Make sure to send me all that on Facebook, please. I want to get that in the slideshow for this week's show.
Okay.
I have no plugs, but I'll be at the Trios just like you're walking around being a mark, I guess.
Just hoping somebody remembers it. Already to that point.
I hope these people remember me.
Hey, Tank, have you still been
Have you still been jumping on the trampoline with your weight?
What? Oh, the Dennis Sam shit? No.
He's not booked, Andrew. He's not fucking booked, okay? All right, well, folks, we will see you Saturday night at the Scenic City Invitational Trios Tournament. It will be my birthday, my 37th birthday in a row.
Holy fucking shit. 37? Yes. Jesus Christ, you are an old motherfucker.
37.
Watch it, I'm older than him.
Yeah, boy. So, come celebrate with me one more time before I turn into fucking dust. That's going to do it for this year, or this week's edition of the Midnight Black Mass. Keep one foot in the gutter and one fist in the gold and a thumb in your ass if you're feeling froggy. Good night.